Today, we're going to make a box joint jig for the router. Not the table saw, not the router table, but the router. You could use a bigger router like this. You could use a smaller router like this. You can't use this router. This router is crazy, insane. It's got some crazy technologies. We're gonna talk about this router in a future video. I made a box joint jig for the table saw a few months ago, and there were a lot of butt eyes. But I live in the UK, dado stacks are not available. I don't have a good table saw. I wanna use a router. David, how can I use a router to make box joint jigs? Today, we're gonna do that. For this method, you can make any size fingers that you want as long as you find the router bit at that size. So the first thing we need to do is take the plate off of the router, and we're gonna make a board that mounts to the router. The really, really important thing about this board is this side of the board needs to be parallel with this side of the board. I'm gonna make this base out of 1/2-inch plywood. So I'm gonna rip it down to 10 inches wide. Then we're gonna cross cut it just to make it smaller and more manageable, and then drill a little hole for the bit to pop through. Now we need to attach it to here, but to figure out where to drill the holes, we're gonna use the plate that we took off, and we're gonna set it on there, center the circles there, and we can mark out where we need to drill. We not only need to drill through, but we need to do a counter bore so the screw will sit below the surface. Got that last one in there. Now we got a little router table. Now that we got the base mounted to the router, we're going to make the sled. The sled is basically the cutoff of this, but we're gonna put it on there this way, and we're going to glue and screw rails on the bottom here that's gonna run right along this. That's the reason this side needed to be parallel with this side, so this runs true. We'll take this off of here, and we're just gonna kinda line that up where we want it. Needs to be able to slide like that. So that needs to be nice and tight. So I'm gonna throw some clamps on there. It's a little too tight, but that's better than too loose. That means we can finesse. Now this is probably overkill, but woodworkers overkill everything. I'm just gonna throw some screws in there. I'm sanding everything real smooth. We're gonna put some wax on there. I got the first part of my fence cut, and we're just gonna glue it on right there. Got that fence clamped on there, but I'm also going to run a couple screws in from the bottom. We need to be able to run through the bit, so I'm just going to slowly run the bit through. For this front fence, I want it a little taller than this. I don't necessarily want it this tall, but something a little bit taller will give us a little bit more clamping room and stability for our pieces that we run through there. So I'm gonna go cut this one down. I'm gonna cross cut it to width and then rip it to, I don't know, about that much. I realized before I can really move any further, I gotta figure out a way to keep this from doing this business. So I'm thinking about making some legs, maybe out of 3/4-inch plywood, and have a front leg that goes down to the bench, but then the back leg is even longer, so it fits into the vise, and then it's nice and secure and stable. Pocket hole screws for the win. So now I can screw my router in there. There we go. We got some airspace for that vent there. Our sled right along top. We're good to go. This is the front of our fence. We need to cut the kerf into this fence here so we can figure out how big to make our pin. So I'm just going to hold this up against the fence nice and tight and run it through the bits. So now we're gonna make a little key that's gonna fit right in there. And we'll have to sneak up on that cut over at the table saw. And I'm gonna use a piece of hardwood and not plywood for that key. That's gonna do it. It doesn't need to be that long. So we'll make it, oh, let's say that. And we're gonna use this scrap piece here. Now we'll glue that guy in there, set that up against my back fence, move this over until that kisses the bit, and then clamp this in place. I have a couple pieces of scrap here, and we're gonna make our test cut. So I'm just gonna bump that up against the pin, and wish me luck. That is a really good fit on the first try, which is kind of unfortunate because I wanted to show you what happens when you don't have a good fit. If it is too loose, you move the pin away from the bit. And if it is too tight, you move the pin towards the bit. And what that does is, even though the grooves that we cut are all the same size, it changes the size of the pins here. So now I'm just gonna take some screws and screw the back fence to the front fence to make this permanent, and then we can remove the clamp. I wanna put a stop so this can't go any further and I don't blow out the back of this and then hit my thumb with the bit someday, because that would kind of suck. Cool, so now we should have a nice little safety stop. Yeah, so now that can't ever go through. What we need to do is set the height of our bit, and it wants to be just slightly taller than your piece, like just a hair. The trick is you need to mark the top of the four pieces that you're going to make, and this mark always faces towards the bit. So we'll put it up against that pin, we'll run it through, we'll flip it over, we'll butt it up against that pin and run it through. So we have our two long sides cut. Now to get the short sides started, I need to take one of these long sides and flip it this way, mark towards the pin, remove some of that dust. We'll talk about that in a second. That's gonna go over the pin right there. And then we're going to run this through, mark towards the pin, to create that first cut. Once we have that first cut, we can then put that over the pin. So we need the long side to get the short side started. And we'll have to do that when we flip it over. And we'll also have to do that on this one and then this one. So obviously the dust collection trick is to have a Dan in your shop who can get in there. I might experiment with some drilling some holes in there and then getting some suction underneath. I mean, minus the dust, that was really easy. Do you know what else is really easy? Making a website with Squarespace. I know, you don't want to hear about Squarespace right now because you're enjoying the box joint jig, but that was so pleasurable to use, and so is Squarespace. I use Squarespace for my own site. I use Squarespace for my podcast site. I used to be a web developer, so I know the pains of making a website. And Squarespace takes away all that pain. You don't have to worry about back-end code. You just set up your site with Squarespace. You pick one of their beautiful templates and you're good to go. It works on mobile phones, tablets, and desktops. That's called responsive design, which makes it readable on your phone, nice big text, and then reconfigures itself for a tablet and then for the desktop. Squarespace does all that for you automatically. You can sell both physical and digital plans, which I do. It works out really well. You can take credit cards, you can take PayPal, all that standard stuff. So we are going to finish this box up. I'm going to take it over to the table saw and I'm gonna cut a little groove so we can put a bottom in there. And while I'm doing that, you should go set up your Squarespace website. Let me know in the comments down below the link to your new Squarespace website and I might feature you next month. We're actually gonna use this next week to build a walnut toolbox. It's gonna be the sexiest walnut toolbox you have ever seen. One thing to keep in mind is the bit length. This is the bit that I originally wanted to use, but it did not come up far enough for me to box joint 3/4 inch material. So I had to find another bit that was a little bit longer. I'm gonna try to find a 1/4 inch bit on Amazon and I'll post a link down below. Also make sure that this base top is made out of 1/2 inch plywood. If this was 3/4 inch plywood, I don't think that bit would come up far enough for 3/4 inch material. You don't need plans to build this, but I will have drawings up on my website so you can see what size mine is. This red zebra wood box, I think I'm gonna throw it up on eBay. I think, we'll see. If so, I'll have a link down below. The zebra wood did come from my friends at Kencraft. You're gonna wanna check them out at kencraftcompany.com. As always, have fun, be safe, stay passionate, and make something. Dan, my energy's back.